following interview was conducted with Mary Louise Foster for the Purdue University Oral History Project. It took place on Wednesday, October the 4th, 2006, at her office in Matthews Hall. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Let's start by asking you to tell us where you were born, your parents and early life and community and siblings, if any, and go ahead with that.
I was born in Fayette County, Indiana, Connersville, Fayette Memorial Hospital. My parents were farmers and had lived in that community all their lives, had gone to school together and married. Many people in the community were family relatives. I had twin sisters. They were 5 years younger than I, and we all went to the same community high school, which of course is a consolidated school now, but we went through all the grades of school there. And at the time, I was about the fourth or fifth grade, they built a new school. My father was on the school board at that time, so we got in on the plans for building a school and all the complaints in the community about spending extra money on schools and so forth. But my mother and dad were strong on education, so the school got built and we were the better for it because it was a nice small community high school. In fact, my high school, I'm saying small, I tell students now that I was from a small school, and when I say small, I mean my graduating class was 12, six boys and six girls.
Was your grade school, what was the grade school like? Was that?
It was always in the same, it was a building when I started to school, that my mother had gone to school in, and my dad. So it was an old frame, two-story building with a gymnasium built on top floor. And it had been in school for a number of years. I would have to figure how many, but when my mother went to school, it was not a new school then. Because it was a fine new school, because they had done away with the one-room schools all around the township, and built this one school.
When were you born? What can you
say, Derek? Oh, yeah, February 18, 1921.
All right. And then, was it grade school? Was it close to home? Could you walk?
We could walk. It was out of sight of home because it was on the other side of a hill. And so my mother never liked for us to walk. So she would take us to school in the car, or she would take us to the end of a long, long lane to catch the bus. The bus did not have to stop for us because we were too close to the school. But a farmer friend was a school bus driver, and he worked with my dad, and so he was very glad to
give you
stop and pick us up.
Sure, that's right.
And mother didn't want to go to school and take a pie to the teachers or some of the things she loved to do.
Sure. Now, your high school, what specific courses did you take in high school?
In high school?
Was it a general course or?
General, yes, general courses, no college prep, of course, no home economics at that time in the school. The foreign language was Latin. I had typing, and the typing class was taught by the coach who didn't know how to type. And so girls taught themselves while the boys and the coach did.
You said there were only 12 people in your class?
In my high school class, my senior class.
What was the size of the school overall?
Well, I don't know. We'd have to figure, but it was
pretty small.
It was a small school. Yeah.
Sure. Uh-huh. Okay. Were there any teachers that you recall made any impact on you when you were in high school?
Oh, yes.
You want to make a comment?
My first grade teacher was five, a friend for life. Her son became a lawyer, and he would come to school and give old lectures to us just to be things that something new for the students. And,
sure.
My name is one of the interesting things in my history, because I know who has left me a message or who has is trying to get in touch with me by whether they call me Mary, Mary Louise, Mary Lou, or MLF. Because when I was in my first grade, there were four Mary Louises, and the teacher was Mary Louise. So we all had to take our name that we were going to use. So I became Mary, because another little girl was Mary Louise. And my family, still to this day, only calls me Mary. I have nieces and nephews that don't know who Mary Louise is. And I had one group of cousins that always called me Mary Louise, and nothing ever different. Then when I came to college, of course, Mary Louise got cut to Mary Lou. So I became Mary Lou, and there are a lot of people that only, they think that's my name. There's no Louise to it. So that's the way that
how it came about.
How things go. That
I learned in preparing for the interview that you graduated from Purdue in 42. What was your major, and how did you happen to choose Purdue?
Oh, I chose Purdue because of 4-H. My first trip to Purdue was the 4-H Roundup. And I decided then that I had to go to college because I wanted to be just like my home demonstration agent, Virginia Brown. And at that time, you had to teach 2 years before you could become a home demonstration agent. Of course, that terminology now has become home educators. But so I started out do the teacher route because I wanted to be to work in 4-H.
Did you reside on campus?
I resided. That's another very different story for me. I've had experience in about all types of campus living. I lived in the residence halls as a freshman. Lived in, at that time it was North Hall, which is now Bruce Shealy. Then West Hall was completed at the end of my freshman year, and I moved over to West, and while I was there, it became Wood Hall. So now it's all the halls there together are Windsor, and I was very fortunate that last year I was invited over to Windsor just to experience a new eating service there, a food service, and I thought it was, very different than what. Of course, when I was in undergraduate, is when the you had table service 3 times a day, and we thought it was just great when they put in a cafeteria for us that we could go to breakfast on our own. Otherwise, we had to wait for the head resident to enter the dining room. We had to wait till she finished at her table. And her table was supposed to be filled first. We didn't have, that's one thing, we didn't have assigned seats. But you were supposed to be in line so that the first few people, 10 or whatever, were at the table, sat at the head resident's table. And so you had to sit there with her. The whole dining room had to wait until the head resident was ready to leave. We had men waiters, student waiters, and not dress every meal, except some meals we did have fancy dress, we really had to dress up.
Very different than today.
Very, very different. It makes me very interested in to see how the food service has changed. Uh-huh.
Then you were served your meals?
Yes.
Okay. Did you experience any was there in a residence home where they did have cafeteria?
No, not
that. So all the time you were here was all served?
Because at that time, you see, there was only just 3 women's residence halls.
Now, you were here during the... So can you tell us how was the campus in the 40s, and that was during the time of the war and afterwards? What was the campus?
Well, another thing, if I can back
sure.
up to the...
please do.
To the... where I lived. Yeah. At the time, I was an undergraduate. A group of girls from one of the corridors that I lived on in, I think, North Hall, freshman year, decided to form a co-op house. And they formed a co-op house over across from Matthews Hall. And they were my very best friends. I wasn't a member of the co-op, but I spent as much time, or more than some of the co-op people, and participated as much in the preparation and the other work around the co-op house. That was called the Antigonish House, and I still, to this, till they, I think, disbanded having reunions, was invited to their reunions over the years, because I was just a part of that co-op in as a guest, I guess you would call it. And then as a graduate student, I was a... became a financial advisor to help a local sorority, one of the sorority houses, and then they made me an honorary member. So I know about all the types of campus living, except living out in apartments, which I do now.
Right. Was that co-op, would that have been the first one on campus?
No, I don't believe it
there
was.
There were others at that
time. There were others at that time.
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Uh-huh. Well, then, going on about, what was the, tell us a little bit about the campus life when you were here as a student, as an undergraduate.
Oh,
In the 40s, late
30s? In the 40s?
Yeah.
Well, you didn't wear slacks. You didn't wear shorts. You were always dressed in campus clothes, which were dressy clothes,
sure.
But compared to some of the
right.
clothes that students wear now, you never went in anything that you would...
It was more dressed.
Oh, yes, definitely.
Uh-huh.
And when you go to the music hall, that was dressed also, even gloves and hats. See, gloves and hats were in my day, too.
Interesting. Were there any professors that made an impact on you that you kept in touch with, or could tell us a little bit about?
Many of them, really.
What was your major then?
Home economics, okay. Education.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Uh-huh. And at that time, most everybody did. You either took dietetics training or home education training or general home economics, which didn't prepare you to do any professional job. You could get any kind of job, but it would not be one of the professions of like a dietitian or a teacher. And then when I went on to do a master's after 10 years of teaching in Indiana high schools, I continued with vocational education and home management and family economics, which is really the same thing as I'm working in now in consumer economics.
I see. Okay. And were you in any specific clubs or student organizations when you were here?
Well, everybody in home economics belonged to the home ec club.
Okay.
That was just part of it.
Sure.
And I belonged to a campus club for the church I belonged to. That was about the extent of the club. Well, we always participated in anything 4-H going on. Those of us, most of us, were very active in 4-H.
And then when the 4-H from your area came, you probably were involved with
yes,
them. Right?
Yes,
and they were. That made sort of home people coming.
That's right. Yeah.
That's a big organization.
Yes.
Yeah, still.
And I had a 4-H scholarship. I just wouldn't have gone to college.
Or did you have
it hadn't been
was that
4-H.
What helped with 4-H scholarship? Is that
yes.
what you got?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay.
Because I went to State Fair, Indiana State Fair Girls School, and got a scholarship from that. as well as my judging awards and just a general 4-H.
Do you still go to any of the 4-H programs at all?
Oh, yes. I'm very, very, and my nieces and nephews that are 4-H leaders and very active in 4-H.
That's very good. You keep that, kept that on.
Yes, it's, yes, as I say, my first experience was to come to Roundup, and I had some part in a presentation. I could tell you what it is now, but the main thing of that time was that I remember was making this presentation from the stage of Fowler Hall. And of course, Fowler Hall was a building in of itself because it was the big meeting place before Elliott. See, Elliott Hall of Music was being built when I was in school.
Fowler, what sort of presentations did you do? Was it for the 4-H?
Yes, for the 4-H Roundup.
And they would have programs in there?
That's right.
Okay.
Yes, because that was the only meeting place to get the whole group together.
They didn't use
Because we didn't have Stewart Center, we didn't have a union.
The union was built.
Well, but we didn't have access to having meeting kinds of, like we could have in Fowler.
Sure, okay. How about Chauncey Village? How has that changed?
Oh.
What was it like? Of course,
Vaughn's was the post office. And there
but was Harry's was here.
Harry's was there.
Yeah.
The dime store was there. It was a Woolworths, I believe. We had a grocery, a pharmacy, two or three clothing stores. You know, almost like the stores in the mall that appeal to the young people, there were clothing stores like that in the village.
Okay.
Three or four that I can remember of.
Yes. I remember a couple of them when I first came here.
Yeah. Also, I'm still a Silk Bank at the same bank that I was introduced by my college roommate. My college roommate's mother took me and helped me open an account at the Purdue National Bank, you know. And so I've gone through all the many changes of the name of the bank. from there to Chase.
So have others been. That's Sullivan and a lot of people.
And it's safety deposit boxes are in the area that used to be the bank. All that there was to it was just that little triangle there at the end where you went in and the tellers were there and so forth. And I'm always just amazed how little that looks, how small that is when you go to the lockbox and there's just that little space. This used to be the bank.
That's right, right?
That's right.
tell me, now, following graduation, you mentioned this earlier, I guess you went into teaching, or what did you do after you graduated from Purdue?
Yes, I had this good friend from the residence hall days, whose uncle was a trustee, a township trustee of Pittsburgh Township out west of Indianapolis. And the other thing I haven't mentioned that some people don't realize, when I was in school, it was during the war, and if you dropped out to go home for summer, you might not come back in school. Some sailor may have taken up your space because we had lots of military men on campus. And so after my freshman year, I didn't take any summers off. I just went to school straight through. Therefore, I graduated in December. And I was very tired of school. And that was back in ration gasoline and tire days. And my dad had saved gasoline and tires to come and haul me and all my belongings back to Connersville. And on Christmas Day, I think it was, I got a telephone call from Pittsburgh. Can you come for an interview? Would you come? And we're in problems with our school. We need a home ec teacher. because our teacher went to see her husband in Texas and she's not coming back. So, with the tire and the gasoline situation as it was, we made it back to Pittsburgh. I interviewed and took my belongings back there and taught there for a semester. My mother became ill, and I then came home to take care of her in the summer that year, and resigned from Pittsburgh. And then again, she got better, and I didn't need to be at home all the time. And the local school was in dire straits for a teacher. They didn't have home economics, but I, being a home ec graduate in those days, you could teach science. You had to have, and you had a biology license, and you had to have another teaching license, and I had chosen civics and economics and that kind of thing. So I went to Harrisburg School to teach physics and chemistry, both of which I didn't learn until I taught them, because I was not very, very good at any of the science courses, except biology. I liked biology. I could do that one. I taught health classes. And I taught a civics class, and I did all these things. The Latin teacher at that time had started a seventh grade home ec class because Indiana law had said every school had to teach home economics in the seventh or eighth grade. Well, a Latin teacher and was not trained in home economics and didn't want to be trained in home economics. And she had been my teacher. She was an elderly lady, and so I lucked into the job of starting a home economics program there. And then I got really brave, and by the time I left in about 3 years, I had started a boys' home economics class, which was, you know, an unheard of thing in those days. Because, see, when I was in here at school in Purdue, there was one boy in my graduating class. He was an institution management major, and he became official in the food stores for Purdue after he graduated. This was my beginning of teaching, was teaching science and being glad that I knew how to teach home economics.
Oh, yes.
Then I went on from home economics from then on.
Very good. Now, I learned that you got your master's degree in family economics in 1954. What prompted your decision to come back and do graduate work?
I went from Harrisburg School, I went to Newcastle Junior High School, and I taught there 3 or 4 years, and the principal called me in one day and he says, it's time for you to get your master's. And of course, at that time you had to get either so many hours or a master's to keep your teaching license. And he said, you choose when you want to leave, but we want you to go get your master's. So I came to Purdue to get my master's.
Did you take a leave from the school? Or?
No, I didn't. Then when I was finishing, one of the major things I wanted to do in my master's work in education was to train student teachers. And the opportunity I had was to teach at Delphi while I was finishing my master's and had student teachers there. Mm-hmm. And then when they said, Purdue called on me to come back to work in the home management area, I said, oh, I don't want to leave student teachers. You know, I like working with student teachers. And then I finally came to my senses and thought, well, if I come back, work in the home management house, I work with every one of the student teachers. And I get to train them on how to be a laboratory manager. So that's what we did in the home management house.
Okay.
Because by that time, home economics education was about the only part of the school that was a required course for.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it was a lot of students at that time, but food and nutrition and the housing and the child development students were not taking home management house at that time.
Was your degree in your master's, was it from the home economics education rather than from the school of education?
No, it was from home economics.
Home economics, okay. Right. And then you became a faculty member in 1955.
Yes.
How did that, they wanted you to come back? Is that how it came about?
In the home, yes.
Okay.
They wanted me
to
work with Dr. Fitzsimmons in home management houses.
And that is that when... Is that when you moved into varsity, do you think? Or no, you moved into the home management house?
In the home management houses.
Okay.
Yeah, there was a house on State Street. It was an old farmhouse. That was house one. And it was right across from, at that time, the dairy farm. And then on to farther where Fowler House is, was the apple orchards and the... poultry farms.
Oh, my Lord.
So, you know, we were just out in the country, really.
Oh.
It's just very hard to see that in as you drive around campus now. But I constantly think of that, of the things that used to go on in these areas. Then the house, too, was an old house that was on that circle that goes around to the residence hall. And then... House 3 and 4 were smaller brick houses that were on the lawns of, Dumi and Sheely. And one of the houses, we first used house 1, 2, and 4, because 3 was still occupied by professor's wife. Those two brick houses were moved from the site of when they built Carey Hall. And the professors then, they moved the houses for them, and they could live there their lifetimes, and their wives could live there, their spouses could live there too. So it was always, we were very friendly with the lady that lived in house 3, but it was, people always ask us, you know, why didn't we use that house? Well, that wasn't ours yet.
We're waiting.
Yes.
Now, my question, Lillian Gilbreth. We talked a little bit about that on the phone. You've met Lillian?
Oh, yes.
Tell us a little bit about your interaction with Lillian.
She was a very charming lady, as everybody I think knows, but the thing that I enjoyed most about her, the mailboxes were where we congregated to go into
what,
the dining.
No, excuse me for interrupting. What hall?
This was Wood Hall. West.
She would stay in Wood when she
was. Yeah, she was staying there.
Excuse me. For
when she was. No, that's right. She just belonged there in my mind. When she was on campus, she lived there. And she would eat in the dining hall with the rest of us, abide by the rules like the rest of us had to abide by. And she would get her mail while waiting to go into the dining room. And she would ask us, well, she'd read her mail, and she would make these, you know, comments about, what do they want me to do about that? She said, would turn to us and say, what would you do? What would your mother do if you ask her? And then she'd ask us the question one of her dozen children had written her about. Because she was just astounded as to, why would they ask me that? How can I answer that, you know? And then she would turn to us and And of course, most of us would have some comment about, well, I know what my mother would say.
That must have been an interesting time to pick up your mail.
Oh, yes. And of course, we always liked to sit at her table.
Did you get a chance? Did you sit at the
table? Oh, yes. And she would sit around wherever she wanted to. And we would
there was space
be,
to get there.
We hoped that we could get to sit with her.
Uh-huh. Did any of her children ever visit her or come with her when she was
not
on campus?
Not that I can remember.
Okay.
Now, they may have, but there's never anything in my memory
Were her stays very long, or did this vary?
I think it varied.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Maybe sometimes she was... And then sometimes we would miss her with our... she had luncheon meetings or something like that. She didn't eat there. But she'd be getting her mail, and then we'd always be sad that she was going to leave before, well, the dining room opens always to talk with. And then she would have, we would have after dinner lectures series.
Activities in the residence hall?
In the residence hall. And she would fit many times with a speaker.
Did she ever give a program at all? Did anybody?
Oh, yes.
Oh, did she?
Yes.
What would she talk?
Well, she would just, if there was a certain topic that was being talked about at that time, she would join in on that. But then she would always, give her views, or she would sometimes talk about other universities she's been to and experiences she's had with other students.
May I ask you this? Do you think the students knew who she was, really?
No.
Oh.
No, I don't think so.
Okay. It was just, well...
Now, the students that I have taught since that have had... when I taught organization and work simplification, we used Cheaper by the Dozen book and, sections of it, because that was one of the assignments for student teachers that I was working with, to develop lessons around the Gilbreth theories and base it on the book so it would make it more interesting to high school students. Mm-hmm. And so I was looking through the file there today on the Gilbreths in my file here, and I have a copy of the lesson plan and the Cheaper by the Dozen book. And that's when I've had students working on here in the office, and I would ask them to get something from the file or be working on something, preparing something for that file, the history file. They were always just fascinated. They didn't know the book, but they knew the movie, if modern students.
Well, let me ask you, mm-hmm. then, if she gave some talks, they just didn't realize, did they know she was a visitor on campus?
They knew she was something
very
important. Yeah,
okay.
She wasn't just somebody walking in the door.
Because she wasn't there all the time.
No, but I don't think we have the idea of just how important she was.
Mm-hmm. In retrospect.
Yes, right.
Okay. Now, Amelia Earhart, did you?
I did know Amelia Earhart. She was here, she's here after I came to school, of course, but she doesn't, living in the hall and teaching and as active as when I came, as she was when a cousin of mine was here. And lived in Doomy Hall is where she lived, uh-huh.
Right.
And she had lots of stories to tell us. And then my cousin learned to fly at that time because of the interest.
I'll have to get your cousin to share those things on there.
Yeah.
Talking a little bit, there was one thing that I came across. Purdue Retailer, that was a retail institute that did some sort of a newsletter. Do they still have that, or you don't know? That was around 1988. There was something called the Purdue Retailer I happened to come across.
Well, I think it is now called our CFS newsletter.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Because now it's the whole department is not separated out. I think that's what that refers to is.
Now, talking about your teaching, has the department, you've been in the same department, or have there been departmental changes? Tell us a little bit about your teaching. And
yeah, many, many, many changes, of course, because the whole school has changed name and from school to college and so forth. And I've never resisted those changes like some people. You know, we still have, I work with the ambassadors for the school and give them a little history of the school always when they start out. And one of the things we try to impress on them, you're going to find people that will blame you as young people. Why don't we have home economics anymore? And then most people can't even figure out how, you know, to say CFS and consumer family sciences. And that is still a very much of a problem for many of our alums. And we still have people that resist that change. But through the years, I've found it interesting, particularly being here in Matthew's hall, the different uses have been made of the different parts of this building. You see, before Stone Hall, everything was in this building, the cafeteria and all of that, all the art department and so forth. Now, there was another building where Bearing is now, just a very small building that was one of the first buildings of the university that our overflow from home economics was child development on the ground floor and art department on the second floor. And where the fountain is out here between Stone and Bearing and University Hall, that was the playground, you know, for the child development before it became a parking lot. And in fact, it had apple trees in it and so forth. The railroad ran along where the sidewalk is out here, taking coal down to the engineering administration building now, which where all the heating plant was. And that was one of the problems, is to get the children into the playground before it was time for the train to come, one way or the other. But of course, the children like to have it come just to be going across to the playground or back to the building just as the train was coming. So, because they would blow the whistle and the engineers would wave at them and holler at them. And they even got so they knew their names, you know, and would call the children's names out, or the children would call the engineer's name. And so it was always a fun time to be working with the child development program at that time. But, of course, the auditorium here in Matthews has been the same. It's still a big lecture hall for the whole university to use. Well, it has changed, of course, in furnishings, but I remember Dean Matthews was teaching the housing course and would come down the center aisle to teach the course, and they have all of my classes, of course, were here in this one of the other two buildings, child development building or Matthews. The third floor was the food labs, the second floor was the clothing labs, and the art department was in this building part of the time. Institution management was on the first floor.
Where, you said there were eating facilities in this
building? Oh yes, the institution management labs were down in the section is now the computer room. Right.
Was the basement used at all? Is there a basement to this building?
No, there's no basement.
There is not.
No,
okay.
It's just the first, just the
just three floors.
Floors.
Okay.
Yeah, that's how we can tell when students come wandering through freshmen hunting their class in Math 601. Well, there's no sixth floor in here. You have the wrong building. This is Matthews, not Math.
Right, yeah.
We get this all the time.
We get people looking for come into Stewart and they're looking for Stanley Coulter.
Yes.
They have an abbreviation.
Oh,
SC,
that's
you
right.
Know,
yeah.
So we get
the same thing. Uh-huh.
Right, yeah. Tell us a little bit about your interaction with the students. How's that changed over time?
Oh, it has changed in a lot of ways. But students still like to have a university, either administrator, teacher, graduate student, whatever your capacity is, interested in their particular problem. They'd like this one-on-one. Now, they'll say they want to do their own registration, they want to do their own thing online, but when it comes to a question or something, they want somebody they can go to, and they like that one-on-one. I was working with a young man that's in science now. He's decided he wants to come into financial counseling and planning. He's done his homework. He looked up on the internet a career choice survey, and he took that. It works out. He's working the right direction. Finances is what he should be. He wants to do a minor in economics because he just thinks that's the most interesting thing there is. And it was interesting how much new technology he had used on his own to decide where his career. Well, he's already been over to CCO and knows how to write a resume and has registered over there as a freshman. But he now is ready to make a change. And he was most grateful for the time I sat down and explained to him what courses he would need to take, what kind of jobs he could get in financial planning. And it shows me that students still want some hands-on personal touch.
Do you think that technology has helped them in some of their career planning? And,
oh,
and
I think
the students,
yes,
that come now are much more techie-oriented.
Oh, yes, yes.
Because they have it at the lower levels.
Yes, uh-huh.
And that makes a difference, too.
Yes, when we first started having a requirement for taking a computer science course, which was very elementary. They didn't have, at that time, they didn't have, many high schools didn't have those facilities, and students didn't have them at home. And this beginning course, you could ease their fear of doing something like learning to use a computer by saying, well, you'll learn how to print your name out, you'll have, you know, all these things that will prepare you to do certain things in your professional life. And so it was, you know, after a while, you didn't have to convince somebody that they needed to take a computer science course.
They figured they would need it.
Yes,
they
or they came and already knew more than I know about it.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because they kind of, I know my first and second grade nieces and nephews. You know, they're computer smart.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes they can help us out too.
Yes. You know,
right?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
They don't know what our problem is.
Did you ever? Were we ever a faculty fellow?
No, I wasn't.
Have you been?
Yes, I know about the program, and I think it's very
have fun. You been an advisor to the student organizations within the school?
I didn't go into the faculty fellow program early because I was still involved in the management house, and I was a faculty fellow there. yes, I've been the honorary club on the Capitol Crown New. I've been the advisor for that. Other, you know, various clubs, and then I've worked very closely with the financial planning club now as far as posting notices about their meetings or giving out.
You're not the advisor for the club.
I'm not, no, that's a faculty person.
Mm-hmm.
But, and then any other, like the PRO, the retail management group, I have some retail management students as advisees, and I, you know, provide them with information about their mm-hmm. professional, their organization. So I'm very interested in seeing that students, and that's one of the things I told this young man the other day, that even before he gets his papers changed over so he's and registered in our school, he can still go to financial planning meetings and meet the students. Mm-hmm. And take part.
Yeah. You mentioned earlier about the ambassadors. You must have some involvement with
yes.
the school ambassadors.
Yes.
Are they, is it on 1 year? How is that set up?
It's usually a 1 year sometimes. And I know this year we have somebody that is a third year ambassador, which is rather unusual. It's usually one or a 2 year thing. It's usually during the junior, senior year.
I was going to ask you what it was, junior and senior year.
Yeah, right.
Okay.
All right. Well, I think that covers all the majors in the college, and we try to keep it as even as and with the various
within the departments,
departments.
And with schools.
Yeah, so if there's somebody, if you're going to an area that wants to know about institution management or home management or the fashion, that you'll have somebody as an ambassador, at least one or two ambassadors that are
in that
informed
program.
In that program. Uh-huh.
Right. Okay. Well, I think we'll stop for now, if that's okay. And...